This is for the week of June 13th to the 18th. Here we go. All right, it's Monday morning and it might rain today. In fact, I'm getting a little bit of droplets of rain right now. So I'm going to harvest this arugula immediately, even though I might not sell it till Friday. I'll sell some of it throughout the week, but not much of it. Most of it will be sold Friday. I'm harvesting it now because it's starting to go to flower. You can see here the odd little flower coming up. So I'm in sort of a mad dash to crop this out right now and then turn these beds over immediately, because I'm not going to get any more cuts from this because it's going to go to flower more and more. So I'm cropping it out now while it's dry. That's why I'm in a mad dash to do it before it really starts raining. That way the greens will preserve well throughout the week, and then I can get these other beds planted to something else. Boom. All right. Done. Haven't weighed it yet, but I think I got about 60 pounds or so. So that was the second cut. So this time of year, arugula has given me two cuts. And on that second cut, it's already starting to flower. So it does get to a point in the summer when it's really hot where I just get one cut. So at that point, it's like a 21-day crop, turnover from seed to harvest, cut, turn it over, it's done, something else goes in the ground. So right now I'm still getting good yields off it. All right, remember these beet greens? We cut these mid last week. Already ready for a second cut, so I'm going to cut them right now, and I bet you they'll be ready for another cut by Friday. All right, our tomatoes are doing very well now, and I was about to put these lettuce beds to rest because they've been cut at least three times, but I figured this one has bounced back so well, I might as well just get another cut from it. So that'll be a fifth cut from this bed, meaning that I've pulled well over 100 pounds of lettuce off this, like probably 120, maybe even 180 pounds. Super productive. Our tomatoes are doing very, very well, as you can see here. Lots of stuff on there. And I'll do a video on tomato management coming up soon. But might as well get another cut of lettuce before I finish this bed off. Well, it's Tuesday morning and Monday went by pretty quick. We got some heavy rain in the afternoon that we had to work in for about 3 or 4 hours. It was really uncomfortable, so I didn't really film much content during that time. But anyway, it's Tuesday morning. I've got a lot of orders to put together right now, so I'm just kind of doing that. Mark is over in the back here planting our Salanova lettuce. So we're already on to the second succession of stuff being planted onto our neighbor's plot here. And so he's just laying down fabrics and putting Salanova in there. We did these two beds yesterday in the rain. It was pretty uncomfortable. And today I'll be cropping out most of this turnip bed for some orders. And this week we'll be putting some more basil in another bed there. And this tunnel here, all these greens are officially done. So I went and cropped out the last of this yesterday, and now our tomatoes are doing really well. And now it's just going to be tomatoes in this tunnel until the fall, when we'll interplant this again. All right, we're at one of our other high rotation plots, and we haven't really given this plot much attention this year, so it's kind of gotten a little out of hand. Mark is pulling out the arugula that went to flower last week in the heat, and right now I'm putting in some semi-permanent infrastructure. Normally I don't do this on my plots, but our landowner here is happy to have us do it, and we needed it because we've just been piling up residual organics that we're pulling off the field, just piling up here, and which isn't very useful, and you know, putting them back at our place eventually, which is a lot of schlepping of compost. So just building a real simple compost bin here, just made of four wood pallets. I always start with three and leave the front open, and then once it gets about halfway or three quarters full, then I put the front back on. And I'm just screwing them together. It's really simple. There's nothing really special about this design at all. It's just a bin, and I've cut a hole in the landscape fabric so that it's on the ground, so that way I'm not getting any sort of anaerobic stuff rolling off on the fabrics. Even though the fabric is perforable, I'd rather just have it on the ground there. All right, so we're doing a decent amount of work here. We are cropping out these beds, turning them over. Mark's pulling them up by hand, and then we're putting all that stuff in our new compost bin. And as I was here, I discovered that There's more ready here than I thought there was. These radishes, which I didn't even technically need, are ready. So I didn't bring everything I need to harvest them, so I'm gonna come back and get them, but I'm gonna go and kinda take, oh, so you kinda figure these things out as you go. And so I'm gonna harvest this bed of arugula, though I wasn't planning on it, but I'm going to harvest it anyways. If I cut it now, it'll be ready again for next week, so I might as well cut it now because it's perfect. And this Red Russian has to be cut. That's what I came here to do. And so I'm going to harvest these two and take them home. But what I'm also gonna do is, this bed of Red Russian, which has been cut a couple times already, has gone really big, and sort of an accident with it is that it's on the edges. It's got these huge bunches of Red Russian kale. So I'm just gonna harvest them into bunches and sell them at the market this week. Cropped out that bed of arugula. Also gonna crop out these two beds of radishes. Mark is now pulling out that Red Russian kale, and we're gonna replant one of these beds, and the rest of them will just be tarped for a week, and then they'll get planted again next week. But one thing I'm doing right now, I'm gonna make a separate video on this, but just to give you a quick idea, is I'm giving this bed of Red Russian kale a haircut because it got too long, so I wanna cut it a bit shorter. And I'll get into that on the other video. Okay, that's what we call crushing it. We just did a ton of work in one shot, and it's something that I write about in my book, especially for the urban farmers who are multi-locational, is that sometimes it's better to just get everything done you need to get done at one plot so you don't have to come back at all. And so today, well, we basically spent the later part of the afternoon, so we came back here after lunch. So we've been here probably 5 hours, and we pulled out those beds of arugula and stirrup-hoed them, and did the same with that Red Russian bed. And we don't need to plant these beds yet, so we're just gonna keep them covered. This will help decompose the sort of excess matter there, so the next week I can turn them over, it'll be a lot easier to get the tilter through there. Harvested both these beds, the Red Russian and arugula, and then gave that one a haircut. And then we cropped out both those beds of radishes, and then have turned them over and replanting them to arugula right now as we speak. And so that's like a perfect example of high rotation planting. As crop comes out, we amend the soil, we put in our fertilizer, our turkey manure, replant them right away. We also cropped out this bed of turnips here and then replanted it to Red Russian kale immediately. So now, oh yeah, we also planted that segment over there. And when we cropped out those beds of radishes, we took those insect nettings and then put them on the new planting of radishes that we did there that was tarped for a few weeks. So we just got a ton of work done here. It's great. I mean, you can see we probably need to put another compost bin here because of all the radish greens that we have here. But we pulled a ton of product off this plot today. Here is some of it. I reckon that we've got about 200 pounds of radishes in total. We've got about 50 pounds of turnips, and then about 40 pounds of arugula there, plus the one that I did earlier. So we've got about 60 pounds of arugula off that one bed. So that's really good. So yeah, that was a productive session at this high rotation plot. All right, so we put in a long day at that plot. I'm just driving home now. And that was, what did we do there? I think we started back up, we put in at least 5 hours at that plot. And Mark and I were just talking about it on the way out of here as we packed up. We touched every single bed there, except there was two beds of carrots there that we seeded last week, so we didn't have to do anything to those. But we basically did something to every single bed there. We planted a total of 6 beds. We harvested 2. We pulled out 3, and then we tarped them. So, and then I moved one fabric from the one turnip bed to some other ones because I want those. We had some odd shaped 30-foot beds there, and so this one turnip bed had 2 pieces of 25 on it. So I took those off and used them to piece together some fabrics on the 30-foot beds. So it was. We effectively did something to everything at that plot. So that was cool because, you know, we haven't spent that much time in one plot this entire season, so it felt really good to go there and just get a bunch of stuff done. We built that compost bin, and I also went and trimmed some of the trees that she had there that were kind of starting to over encroach onto the some of the beds there. So got a lot done. That's great because we won't have to go back there for a while now. So it's kind of on succession into the next plot.
Hey, Wednesday morning. And I'm doing some not fun stuff, but I wanted to show it to you guys because this is like the reality of what we have to do on the farm fairly consistently. I'm running out of cooler space right now, which makes me think more and more that I probably need to build a bigger walk-in cooler, so that might be a project for the fall. Though we'll be able to get through the season, we can manage it. But what I do to create cooler space is I'm going through what's in the cooler, and I'm sorting out what's in there that we don't need, looking at stuff like in here. These are like market leftovers, so those get composted. So I'm kind of putting them over here in the shade, and I will, you know, go through, open these bags up, put them in the wheelbarrow, then they go in the compost pile. The bags themselves go in the recycling bin. They're recyclable. And what I'm also doing right now is I'm just actually kind of doing some modifications to my totes. I'm just drilling holes in them, so I'm just putting three holes on the sides here. I've just found over the years that a little bit of airflow in there is going to be better for the greens, so that's what I'm doing right now. I'm just kind of emptying totes out, and then I'll clean them out so there's no pieces of plastic in there. And we harvested a ton of stuff at the end of the week last week because it had to come out of the ground, and you know, I've talked about the reasons for doing that before. But so I'm kind of just going through. We were in such a hurry to harvest a lot of stuff, we didn't fully take stock of what we had and where it came from, which is something that I always do. And then I'm kind of re-putting the greens that were harvested in totes without the holes into totes with the holes so they can breathe better and keep longer, because we're sitting on a lot of product right now that needs to move, and it will move throughout the week and near the end of the week. So I'm just doing this to kind of make sure that that product stays fresh and good. For one thing, we're also doing a lot of right now is we're rebranding. We've got some new recyclable clamshell containers, and worked on a label design. My lovely girlfriend helped me do that. My friend Scott actually did the logo years ago, but she helped make the label design. And so I've got a little label printer that I'm printing out these labels ourselves, and we're marketing to grocery stores now, and it's actually become our biggest market stream. It's superseded the restaurants, and it's great because, you know, they're consistent customers and they buy a lot of stuff. You really have to have a lot of your ducks in a row in order to get into grocery stores, but we've been in business going on seven years now, and so we've got a brand, a name behind ourselves, and it's something that people at the grocery stores are asking them for our product. And that's how I got into the grocery stores, is I knew some people working at them. I got to know a lot of people over the years, like social equity, I guess. And people have been asking, how come you don't carry Green City Acres? How come you don't have this and this and this? And conversations started happening, started selling to a couple different grocery stores, and now we're going into more because there's just the demand. What I'm also doing is actually going around and taking these products as samples to some of the other grocery stores that I know, and just dropping off. We're doing four different types of greens. I'm just dropping them off at the stores and saying, hey, here's our product, check it out. And the product is obviously 100 times better than anything that Earthbound would be selling in the grocery stores. And so we're finding sort of a landslide of interest, and it's pretty exciting because it's kind of taking the business in a new direction. And it's something that has always been more of what I wanted to do when I started this, is to get the product in the hands of locals and the public, not just high-end restaurants. And I have no problem with selling to high-end restaurants, but it's nice to get our stuff into the hands of just the common folk. And so that's what's kind of great about getting into these grocery stores. So I'm sure there'll be more of that, the nuances of that, that you'll get in these videos in the coming weeks and years. All right, sorry for the noise in here. All the fans are running in the greenhouse because it's hot outside. So just a little thing for you microgreen growers out there. I've been growing micros since I started, so going on 7 years. And
Growing them in the summer is challenging, especially if you're going to grow them in flats. And one thing I've always done in the past, and I wrote about it in my book, what I used to do is do what's called field micros, is from basically mid-June, even starting sometimes May, until early September, I would grow all my microgreens in the ground, like in the dirt. And it works very well, but it requires you to use real estate on the ground. And the reason I don't do it so much anymore is because I have something like this, and I'd rather keep my real estate on the ground for crops that need to grow on the ground. And if I can grow crops in flats, then I'd rather grow them in flats. But one of the challenges when you're growing micros in the summer is they grow too fast and they get too mature on you. And with the sunflower shoots, for example, once you get the two true leaves like that, that come out between the two cotyledons, it's done. Like it's basically compost. It's no longer palatable. It just tastes like plant. Like it doesn't taste like a vegetable or something that you'd want to eat. Maybe if you were a deer or something, but for us humans, it's not really that palatable. So the challenge is you've got to really monitor how they're growing, even more so in the summer than in the winter, because they in one day they can go on you. So what I've been doing to combat this, and even though I'm showing you a failure here, I want to show you guys everything as far as our successes and our failures. And this is a failure on my part in not watching these closely enough and also putting them in direct light. This group here that all have big true leaves now, like this is all compost, are 1 week behind these ones, or 1 week ahead of these ones. And these ones aren't as bad. And these ones, again, are a week older. So what does this tell me? Well, it tells me that these do better in the summer in ambient light, like that I'm standing in right now, opposed to direct light, like out there. So that's kind of the strategy going forward, is just to keep them in the ambient light in here. They get enough to photosynthesize. They green up just fine. Like you can see these pea shoots. These will be ready next week, coming along here. And they're green. They're photosynthesizing just like plants in the understory of a forest would. So they still have light. They just don't have direct light. And so I'm finding that it's better to just do them in ambient light, especially in the summer. Whereas in the winter time and the shoulder seasons, I want that direct light because I want to accelerate their growth. I want to keep consistent growth cycles happening. So anyways, I just thought I'd share that with you. Sorry about the wind. I'm at one of the high rotation plots, the main flagship plot. And it's awesome. I'm kind of beaming right now. I'm stoked to come here and just see how well these tomatoes are doing. And so this one, the greens have been out for a while in here. Like they've been out for a number of weeks, probably at least 3 weeks. So they're just pumping. And we've got lots of heavy fruit on here. These are ox hearts. These are a special variety of ox heart we've been saving the seed for 2 years now. And we haven't been able to find this seed anywhere. But we love it because it's a really big, slightly different shape than a normal ox heart that has the point on the bottom, so it's shaped like a heart. But it's a really thick, meaty tomato. It's good for cooking, it's good slicer, it's good for sauce. The skin comes off really easy, so we just kept saving it because we like it. And we normally don't save seeds, like lettuce seeds or things like that, because it's just not economical to leave things in the ground that long. But saving tomato seed is really easy because you just have a ripened tomato that you have to save, and you can save those seeds, right? It's not like having to leave a whole lettuce plant stay in the ground for 140 days, right? Which would make my bed production a little bit more inconvenient, and the amount of seed that you actually save on spending is very minor. So whereas tomatoes is something that makes a lot more sense, it's easy to do, and I would encourage anybody to save seed, and not even just seed saving in that way, but seed save from your garden. But to do it from a farm is an entirely different thing. But I think it's important that people do save that seed. So let's look at the other greenhouse. This one's even more exciting because it's loaded with cherries. And we've kept the lettuce in here going extra long, so it's cool because tomorrow we'll probably harvest 60 pounds of lettuce out of here, which is fantastic. The way the greenhouse was planted, we were able to keep these two beds of greens going fairly easily because we can access these two rows of tomatoes from this footpath,
and we can access this row from in here. You know, you gotta kneel down a bit, but just look at the fruits on these puppies. These are Sun Golds in here. Just loaded. I mean, tomatoes are getting better and better every year. We keep picking the better varieties and going with that. And we always try new stuff, but one we tried this year was Sweet Baby Girl. That was amazing. And that's in the other greenhouse at my house. But yeah, doing really well. And it's cool because the tomatoes in the passive solar greenhouse they're just about finished now. And so we're about to come online with tomatoes in here because they're already ripening. So we'll be picking, if we get another good week of weather, of sunshine and warmth, even just sunshine, it doesn't have to be that warm because we can close the tunnels. We'll be getting the first pickings out of this greenhouse to take to market. And just looking over at this plot, this is doing very well. Had some problems at the beginning with some of the root maggot. We had some beds of turnips there. You guys probably remember a few weeks ago, I was harvesting turnips out of there. And they were really maggoty, and it was a drag because it was a mistake I made. Didn't cover enough quickly. And but this bed of turnips, which was one that I'd planted after I discovered that, and so this one is the next succession from there. Well, we've had other successions at other plots, but this is the next one at this plot. And I was really delighted to look in here today and just pull a couple turnips out. Usually what I'll do to get an idea of something is just like pull out a couple random turnips out on a few different places in the bed, and that'll just give me an idea of what I've got. And just like wipe these off my jeans a bit, I've got clean turnips there. So I'm pleasantly surprised, because I didn't have a lot of hope for this bed just because it was one bed away between this Red Russian bed and here of a bed that had root maggot. And so this one was covered from the beginning. It's cool to see that they didn't just migrate over into this. So I was actually kind of very surprised to see that, but no, I'll take it. And our Salanova lettuce is just pumping here now. We will be getting the first cut. We've still got, this week we'll harvest from the greenhouse, and then for early next week we'll be harvesting from a bed at my place. Or my neighbor's place, and then after that we'll be harvesting these guys, and then these guys will go in succession. So depending on how much demand I have at that time, it might be successioning two beds. Like I might harvest these two at once. That'll probably be about 100 pounds or more, and then I'll harvest these two here the next week. By then, because they're all planted at the same time, they'll be bigger, so that could be almost 200 pounds of lettuce. Then we'll be successioning on the ones at other plots, and then by the time it's the third week, then these have regenerated. So that's kind of how I usually think about it when I'm looking at different plots and looking at what's there compared to where everything else is, and kind of just planning my succession of harvests as I see it. I mean, I've got a plan to it to some degree on my spreadsheets, but you know, weather can just throw you a curveball so often that you don't really know how things are going to go until you see them in the ground and they're growing. Then you know for sure you've got that crop. I just want to show you guys something too. This bed of Red Russian kale that I'm standing next to here is a prime example of something that's done. Like, you can see there's little brown tips going on the leaves. They're miscolored. Also, there's a lot of weeds in the bed. And that's what often will happen with direct seeded crops like this that you get multiple cuts from, is weed pressure blows in and then starts to germinate and come up in the understory. And then, you know, that's when I know part of the reason why a bed is done. It's like, oh, a bit too much weed pressure coming in here. I don't want those weeds to go to seed. I've also got enough Red Russian coming in other plots that this bed can be turned over. If I had a fabric with me right now, I'd just roll it over this thing and weigh it down right now and then turn it over next week. All right, Thursday morning, and at this plot harvesting, and I got a lot of stuff coming here. My carrots have done really well. They are fully on stream, and you can see a ton of purslane weed pressure in there, but that didn't come out until they were, you know, 6 inches tall. We've had so much rain in the last little while that all these weeds are new, but frankly I'm not really worried about those weeds for now because they're not going to affect the growth of the carrots too much at this point. To go and hand weed it is probably more work than it's worth at this point, so the carrots will be fine.
once those carrots come out, we'll stale seed bed those beds again or manage the weeds at that point. But right now I've got three beds of arugula to cut, and basically I just have to cut them because they're ready. I don't necessarily need all of it. I actually don't need any of it, but I'll sell most of it early next week. So that's my plan for here right now. And then I'm out of here back to portion and wash veggies. Okay, so didn't tell you guys that when I came here last night, I turned the irrigation off. So I didn't water yesterday. I did that intentionally because I wanted to come here and have these greens be dry when I harvested them so that they, I can just pack them. They're not dirty, so I can just pack them up. So what I'm gonna do right now is turn the irrigation on manual and just run it, and it'll run again tonight. All right, it's Friday morning. Thursday went by. There was a lot of work to do, so it was, didn't have too much opportunity to make videos, but we just did most of our harvesting and packing. Mark has left for the weekend, so I'm on my own for half of yesterday and for all of today. Fortunately though, most of the work is done. I've got most of my packing for restaurants, most of it's done. I got a few more things to put together, and then I'm just going to assemble my orders. So put in each different restaurant or grocery store in a different box, and then just packing stuff for market. So that's kind of how my day is panning out at the moment. All right guys, I'm here at one of my high rotation plots, and it's Friday still, and everything is done for the day. And so now I'm just spending the rest of the day doing some management at this plot that I didn't get to do earlier in the week. And what I'm doing here right now is I'm going to turn these two beds over, but I wanted to show you something. So these beds were radishes earlier in the week that we cropped out, and there's a whole understory of weeds here. So you can see there's some larger size weeds, like we've got some mallow here. That's mallow, and it's a pretty deep rooted weed. Like, this part of the soil here is wet because it's in shade still from the afternoon. You can see that there's the soil soft, so I can actually pull these right out of the ground. But on that end of the bed, where it's more dry because it gets a little bit more afternoon light, I can't pull the weeds out there. So anyways, you can see these weeds have quite a bit of taproot. That means that if I flame weeded this right now, those weeds wouldn't die. It wouldn't kill them. The taproot, they'd just come back from the taproot. So what I'm doing is I'm going in. Well, first I'm just going to flame weed it, because you can see all kinds of little weeds. All that stuff there, that's purslane, and that's a pretty like low crawling weed. It actually doesn't really affect things that much, I find, especially like deep rooted vegetables like carrots. But I'm gonna plant some beets here, and I want to get rid of it before I plant, because otherwise it will overtake the bed and not allow them to germinate. However, if that weed comes along once a crop is mature, kind of just hugs the understory. Like with carrots here, I'll show you in a minute, I've got a ton of purslane there underneath in the understory, and it not really worried about it. Right now I'm just worried about the tall weeds and the weeds that are going to seed I want to manage, and anything on the here before I plant the bed I want to manage. So I'm going to come in with the flame weeder. That's going to boil all these little weeds. Then I'm going to fork these beds, at least on this end here, because it's a lot drier here because it just gets more light. I'll probably turn up the irrigation on this side too. Plus I have this tree here, so that makes it drier here in general. But I'm going to hand manage the big weeds, especially all the mallow. But anything that's really tiny or purslane, I'm not worried about it. The flame weeder will boil those off. And then I'm gonna prep these beds again and plant beets. But what I wanted to show you here is my carrots. You can see I've got mallow coming in my carrots. So let's just get in here. Actually, this part of the carrots isn't too bad in the soil, but I noticed over here in this bed, I have a ton of purslane. So just take a look down there. It's a whole understory of purslane, and I'm not surprised that it's in this area, because this is brand new. I just prepped this year. It was lawn before, and not too worried about it though, because the carrots are now on the overstory. They're going to dominate, and their root profile is going straight down, whereas the purslane is a little bit more of a shallow weed. So they won't actually compete with each other too much for nutrients. So for me to go in and spend time hand pulling those weeds is just wasted effort. It's not really that necessary. The main thing I'm looking for is weeds like this that are gonna go to seed quickly. I wanna get those out. The purslane doesn't go to seed as quick, so I'm not so worried about it. But all these big things, like this is lamb's quarter. It's actually edible, but that I'm just coming in and I'm basically spot weeding here. Anything I see going to flower, and then
gonna flame and turn these beds over.
All right, so I'm just pulling out of that plot. I couldn't do a lot of filming there just because the house is, has actually changed hands. So my garden, a different homeowner, or somebody bought the house basically, but now there's some renters in there, and the person who bought the house was pretty stoked on me having the garden there. So I didn't do a lot of filming today because while I was there, just because the family was there with their kids, and they're, you know, I was working a bit late, so I didn't want to bother them. But anyways, at that plot, I did a bit of passive stuff where I had three beds there of greens that had been past their prime. They'd been cut. Now they're all starting to go to seed. And instead of pulling them out and turning them over, I just tarped them. And so I'll keep the tarp on there for a couple weeks and just let them just bake down. And then it'll be so much easier to get in there and turn them over. So it's something that we're doing a little bit more of this year, just because I have a little bit more land, and so I'm not in a desperation to turn and burn those beds so quick. I can just let them sit for a couple weeks because I've got other beds to plant. So this way it's less work, and so it's kind of a good thing. So we'll see how that goes.
All right, so that's our week. Had a fantastic day at the market, almost completely sold out. I think I came home with like 10 items. So anyways, very productive week. A lot happened on the farm. I apologize that I couldn't get it all on camera, but I think we got enough stuff there to give you a lot of value. And stay tuned this coming week. On Tuesday, I'm going to finally put a video out talking about these guys, talking about tomato management and a lot of the techniques and strategies that we use to maximize the production on our farm. So if you guys like that, please hit the subscribe button right now if you haven't already. Like and share the videos with your friends, and check out my online course, profitableurbanfarming.com, and my book at theurbanfarmer.co, which I reference a lot in these videos. And you know, there's a ton of content in there that answers a lot of the questions that I see on the YouTube comments, and I often just say, just read the book, because some people ask questions that are so big that it would require me to sit there and type for 20 minutes, and I've already done that on my book, so please check that out if you haven't already. And for those of you who would like to make a donation to the show, it is very, very much appreciated, and again, thank you so much for those of you that do. You can do that at theurbanfarmer.co/support. All right, guys, we'll see you again next week.